amount of time he had if he thought maybe he was going to draw a foul, but 59-56, Michigan State gets the win against Ohio State. All right, we have five games matching ranked opponents today. What's the takeaway? What's the biggest thing you saw today? Leaves a lasting impression.
I think the impression I've had, I think, is the same, that we've got some really good teams out there, some outstanding basketball teams. I'm not sure that anybody's separated. You know, last year I felt at this time that Kentucky was on its way to separating past everybody. There were other really good teams. I thought North Carolina was one of them last year, that those two teams were the best teams. I think Louisville's the best team. They certainly didn't finish the game today. They should have. Louisville should have won that game today. You give all credit to Syracuse for winning, but if you're sitting in Rick Pitino's chair, you got to be saying, you know what, we gave that away. We had the lead at the end, had the ball, we should have won.
I think all the teams today that played, Florida, they just got it going, both ends of the floor. You end up getting 21 turnovers for 34 points against Missouri. I don't care. Now that Kenny Boynton's finding his reign to balance with Murphy and what goes on with Young, this Florida team, of all the games today and all the teams today, Florida right now is probably playing the best basketball in the country.
How about props for the mid-major? We're a game right now where it's a number 8 ranked team and a number 13 ranked team. There was a top 6 team playing against the number 1 team in the country, but we're here at the cathedral of basketball
and
in Indiana right now.
And these teams tonight, okay? Look at the road record of Gonzaga. They own the Big 12. What, 4-0? And we can't talk enough about Alex Barlow's shot against Indiana when they were number 1. But when you look at how they played in Maui when you were there against Marquette in North Carolina, these two teams don't need to prove to anybody. They play without fear, and they don't care what it is. They're going to get, it's going
to
be a classic.
They didn't take you to Maui also? What's going on, Digger? Why they take Jay? They didn't take us to Maui?
Maui's doing
we haven't earned it.
Maui's doing a public beautification. they didn't need that. They don't need that.
Man.
It's tough to make this building more attractive or this game. These two powerhouse programs, Gonzaga off to its best start in school history. Butler has played in two of the last three national championship games, and Oscar Robertson once said of playing in Hinkle Fieldhouse, named for the legendary Tony Hinkle, Hall of Famer, who coached all three sports, baseball, basketball, and football here at Butler. That coming and playing a game in this building on this floor was like going to heaven. We're hoping that the game joins that ethereal realm tonight, even though Butler is going to be without its leading scorer, Rodney Clark. You see the Bulldogs coming onto the floor. They're trying to find a way to pick up some of the slack on offense and take care of a very good Gonzaga team on offense, one of only 8 teams in the country that average 80 points or more. So Gonzaga's probably more talented, the deeper, they're healthier. Who wins the game tonight?
You guys are going to get me in trouble with this pick. As much as I want to go with the Butler Bulldogs, since I've practiced on this floor, I've lived in Indiana almost 6 years, I have to go with the Zags because Butler's playing without their best player.
The last time I coached in this floor in 85, we lost. I'm going with Butler because they've got a way to win games they shouldn't win, and they're going to win it tonight because I just feel the motions there.
That's where I am. Gonzaga's better. My head says go with Gonzaga, but I'm feeling Butler. I'm taking Butler.
And Gonzaga had a little bit of a rough trip in, sort of the delayed turning around from Thursday night, see if they had their legs coming from the West Coast. The one thing that Butler won't have is the sharpshooter Rodney Clark in that great range. How will Butler be able to compensate without the transfer from Arkansas? Just about set for the game from legendary Hinkle Fieldhouse on the campus of Butler.
Let's get it.
I'm told I occupy a special place in the center of the Hoosier State and in the hearts of basketball fans. I don't just hold events, I store memories. Keep them locked inside these walls and fresh in people's minds. I've been home to the Bulldogs as they've scratched and clawed their way into the national limelight. And over the years, so many moments, so many sounds, so much excitement, so much love. I'm proud to be a National Historic Landmark, to have played an important part in the growth of the game, and in the lives of so many great players, coaches, and fans. And I'm not done yet.
Historic Hinkle Fieldhouse, one of the most hallowed college basketball arenas in the nation. is our host tonight for a battle of the Bulldogs. National powers Gonzaga and Butler are set to go. Welcome to the Infinity College Basketball Tip-Off. And welcome to an absolutely fantastic place to watch a college basketball game. We've got the Bulldogs from Spokane and the Bulldogs from Indianapolis. And we are all fired up, each of us here for the first time doing our first game here at Hinkle Fieldhouse, where so much basketball history has happened. What are you looking for tonight?
Well, I'm really so excited to be here. My first journey here in 34 years. I've never been to Hinkle, and this place is rocking and rolling. Dan, this is Fenway Park, baby. But I'm looking forward to tonight to a physical performance by Butler against an offensive machine. Great balance when you look at Gonzaga. Both clubs in the last 7 years are the top 10 in the nation in winning percentage.
If Butler's going to win this game, they'll have to do it without arguably their best player. For more, here's Shannon Spade.
Well, Dan, Butler's Rodney Clark, it's just 1 week removed from that scary accident in game that left him temporarily paralyzed for several minutes. In speaking with Clark yesterday, two emotions I picked up on immediately. Number one, he's extremely grateful. He's seen the game film. He knows that it could have been a lot worse than just a neck sprain. Number two, he's frustrated. His recovery and therapy, well, it's been a lot of nothing, just rest. In fact, he shot the ball for the very first time at practice yesterday. He told me he still has a little bit of pain by his shoulder blades. He will be reevaluated after this game, so his return is still to be determined.
Shannon, thank you. You can hear the ovation that he's getting as he hands off the game ball. This has been the Infinity Tip-Off. Now let's take a look at how some coaches have fun with fundraising in the Infinity Coaches Charity Challenge. Welcome to Saturday Primetime, presented by DirecTV. Tonight's game is a part of My Home Court Week, our week-long celebration of the great college basketball arenas and venues around the country. And as Blue 2 will tell you, the mascot of the Butler Bulldogs, this is one of the great venues around the country. Let's go to our one-on-one now. We got two great big guys in this game, Dick.
Well, we got two big guys going to go head-to-head. When we talk about Olenek, he has been on fire. Look at this big guy operating on the post. He can also shoot the basketball, or he's would have done. But he's also a good perimeter player. Has really improved his post ability and has been on fire scoring. On the other side, really an improved player, Andrew Smith. He has come so far from his first year. Unbelievable progress. He's a force on the interior, very physical. We should have an interesting matchup with the two Goliaths going head-to-head.
Let's check out the starting lineups now, beginning with the visiting Gonzaga Bulldogs. Kevin Pangos, Gary Bell Jr. in the backcourt. Mike Hart, an all-time hustler, a do-anything guy on the court. Elias Harris, so talented up front, along with Kelly Olynyk, playing about as well as anybody in the country right now. For Butler, without Rodney Clark, they will start Alex Barlow. Remember, Barlow hit the game-winning shot in overtime to beat Indiana. Kellen Dunham, a very talented freshman. Roosevelt Jones, Kyle Marshall, and then Andrew Smith, who Brad Stevens says has been sensational this year. You'll be hard-pressed to find two better guys as coaches who have had more success than Brad Stevens. Two trips to the national championship game, and Mark Few's taken Gonzaga to the NCAA tournament each and every year that he's been the Zags head coach.
And let's forget about the term mid-major. Nothing mid-major about these programs. Charter planes, million-dollar contracts, live like kings, as that guy Andy Katz wrote about. There is nothing mid-major about the quality of play either.
The Zags beat Butler up in Spokane last year, and the Zags get the first possession of the night, the ball in the hands of sophomore point guard Kevin Pangos.
Tell you one thing, Dan, the Zags can flat out score.
Olynyk on right inside, had it rejected, puts it back up and in, and that is the biggest difference in him since his redshirt year last year. Instead of being primarily a perimeter guy, he's taken that 7 foot body of his inside.
Yeah, he's become much more effective on the post. How you look right now at Butler without Clark, they really lose that threat from the perimeter. A terrific, one of the best 3-point shooters in America.
Balanchet, Roosevelt Jones kept alive, but Olynyk steps out of bounds, and it'll be Butler ball again. There's Rodney Clark. Shannon told you about him in the pregame show. Suffered a scary-looking injury. Fortunately, just a sprained neck. Was on the court for 8 minutes before being taken off on a stretcher last week against Indy. They hope to get him back soon.
Tempo, a big factor here for Butler. They're going to control tempo. Make sure, as they told us before, get a good shot. That was not really a good shot right there.
We've seen two tough shots from Butler. And one of the concerns for Brad Stevens, how big Gonzaga is on the inside, and their size affected both of those shots.
I think also a key factor tonight, they cannot afford Butler to have one of the bigs get in foul trouble. They do not have size to take the bring in. When you look at Gonzaga, they can rotate like four giants on the interior.
Here's one of them, Olynyk. Redshirt junior, he turns it over, but gets it right back as Barlow couldn't throw out.
Tell you one thing about Barlow, physical on the defensive end. They come right after you, and they make you earn your shots, baby.
Elias Harris, the senior from Germany, doesn't get the bounce. Offensive rebound by Hart. That's what he does. Olynyk misses the three, and down with a rebound, the Bulldogs, and we got bodies flying all over the place here in the early going.
You know, Butler coming off a 62-47 win over Richmond. Did it without Clark. Did a phenomenal job defensively. I can't believe the guy's 36 years old. I'm twice his age. I mean, what's happened? Twice the age of a coach.
You're twice his age and half as mature as he is. On a good day.
You're right about that, too.
Jones. Jones, a really unusual talent. Not a good shooter at all. He's got a good floater. Doesn't have a good jump shot. Built like a fullback. And he also leads the team in assists.
He really attacks the basket. Very physical player. He's improved his free throw shooting.
Barlow, the former walk-on, with a three.
He hit the big shot that was heard all over the state, as you said earlier, against the Hoosiers of Indiana. The Canseco.
Doesn't really look to score. He's also a former walk-on. Now, nice look inside for Elias Harris, and he is so tough down low.
Well, you know, he's so versatile. He steps out to the perimeter. He can go inside. He's been around for an eternity.
It seems like
he's been around for a lot of years.
He is one of five players on the Gonzaga roster who is not from the United States. They have players from all over the place. Harris is from Germany.
It's amazing how they find the most. He's worth you before the game event.
Down for you as time permits. Barlow the lob, and a foul underneath on Olynyk. And it's going to send Kyle Marshall to the line for two.
A little set play, back screen, trying to throw a lob over the top. Barlow, what an amazing story. There's that diagonal pass, there's the contact. Think about it. Final game in the NCAA championship 2 years in a row. An amazing tribute to Brad Stevens.
And this close to winning it in 2010 against Duke when Gordon Hayward missed the half-court shot.
We have been a movie. Hoosiers, baby, we're right here. Game Day did a great job today with the Hoosiers story.
Of course, this building is the spot not only where Hoosiers was filmed, but where the story that Hoosiers was based upon, the Milan Miracle of 1954, the Indiana High School State Championships, which at the time was just one class. Everybody plays everybody. That's the way that it was for many years when the state championships were held in this building. And you walk into this building, and it's like you're walking back in time.
Unbelievable. See, their defense makes you slow up the pace of the game as well because they make it so difficult to get a shot, and that helps with their tempo.
Sam Dowry into the game for Olynyk early as Pangos buries a deep three.
He's a point guard who's got that unbelievable range as a shooter. He's a Cousy Award nominee.
Got a little something that you mentioned every now. He's got a little swag, too. He's a very confident young man. 33 points in his debut last year as a freshman, his first game, and he scored 33 points against Washington State. Andrew Smith trying to back down Dower, draws the double team. And a foul is the call. Thought it might be a travel going against Smith.
I tell you, Smith was a real project as a diaper dandy freshman, and he has now become such a major factor. You think of the Atlantic 10, what an unbelievable break they got. Getting Butler and also getting VCU. Now the question is, will they be able to keep Butler? Will they join possibly those seven Catholic schools? That would be unbelievable.
All we know for sure about realignment is we don't know much at all about where it's going and when it's going to end.
Little zone. Yep. He told us he's going to zone.
And they get a turnover out of it.
Got a really interesting reason why he was going to utilize the zone. didn't have a whole lot of time, he said, to prepare for all their sets.
Yeah, Butler runs a ton of sets, and Gonzaga played at Portland Thursday night, then had some plane trouble getting here yesterday, so they just had a brief practice in Portland yesterday before a walkthrough today, so they figured a little zone would simplify things for them.
Look at the passes and the movement of the ball that you have to get a shot down.
Dower, the lefty, knocks down a long jumper, foot on the line. It's a two for Dower, whose minutes have been down because Olynyk's been playing so well, but another very talented player that DeMarcus wants to get in there whenever he can.
See, the one great ingredient they have, they got five potential guys that can put 20 points on the board against you.
Kellen Dunham. Brad Stevens said he would be a big key tonight, the freshman. If he shoots the ball well, they're a very dangerous team. Harris got a screen, gets inside, and lays it in.
So one thing they're breaking down that defense. Dunham is a vital guy. He was the leading scorer in the state of Indiana last year. Committed to that before his junior year.
A great start on the road for the Zags, who are 17-1 on the season. Their only loss to Illinois. Butler is 15-2. One of their two losses to Illinois as well. They also lost at Xavier. And Smith is fouled to take us to our first media timeout of the game. Some foul trouble for the Zags, but they've got an early 7-point lead.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is presented by DirecTV. Don't just watch TV, DirecTV. Call 1-800-DIRECTV. And in part by Infiniti, luxury cars that deliver inspired performance. And UPS. Let UPS put the power of logistics to work for you.
As we mentioned off the top, this is one of the most historic college basketball arenas of the nation. It's also hosted six presidents over the years. Jesse Owens ran here in 1935. The Milan Miracle, Bobby Plump, that shot that led to the movie Hoosiers, happened here in 1954. And Oscar Robertson won a high school championship in this building in 1955. So much history, so many unique things in this building. Let's find Shannon Spake.
Well, Dan, I am all the way up top, and this is a great view. This court that these players are on right now, this court has seen it all because it's the original court from 1928. Now, when this field house was built back in 1928, it was the largest college basketball venue in the country. It's had some renovations. However, it's a historical landmark, so what you see now is pretty much what it looked like when it was built in the 20s. And guys, did you know that they served snow cones? Cool little touch, no pun intended.
Hey, Shannon, I need a snow
Let's
cone.
Let's get a couple down here.
Get me a snow cone, Shannon, come on.
This building seats 11,000 and change, and there is not a spare inch of space in the building tonight. Michael Hart picked up the last foul for Gonzaga. He's gone to the bench with two, and into the game for the Zags. 7-1 freshman from Poland, Szemek Karnowski, number 24, big man in the middle. They go zone again. Barlow misses badly, and here come the Zags.
Tell you what, that zone would light up the eyes of Rodney Clark. I'll never forget Billy Donovan telling me he's as good as a shooter I have seen in my tenure at Florida. Congratulations to Billy on his 400 today.
Routed Missouri.
They're the class. They're going to be my team of the week with what they did against Texas A&M and also what they did right here against an unbelievable Missouri team. Reese Davis had on Thursday, and he said they were awesome.
Beat him by 31. Reaching foul on Cameron Woods, a sophomore from Louisville. Donovan's coming back into the game. Barlow will sit down for Butler. Both coaches will play up to 9 or 10 players, and both coaches kind of had a feeling they couldn't anticipate what might happen in this game as much as they normally do, that they would have to go with the flow.
Tell you one thing about Gonzaga, what makes it special is the terrific balance.
Dower again off the bench with another jumper.
I tell you what, you bring a guy off the bench like that, you got a chance. I think they're definitely a potential Final Four team. I don't know, any doubt, whatever happens here tonight.
It's a 9-0 run right now for the Zags, who have made their last five shots. Deep one for Dunham, and Butler needed that.
Badly, badly. That was a big trifecta by Dunham. He can shut the lights out as a scholastic superstar in Indiana.
Averages 10.5 points per game as a freshman.
They have come up with some stops here. It's been difficult for them defensively, and they're a solid defensive team.
Dower is feeling it and makes his third jumper.
McNeil, but at late size, they're shooting right over the top of the defense. Came back out of the zone, now he's rotating to man-to-man.
And Jones operating as the point guard right now. Again, Clark's not only their best shooter, he's their primary point guard. Chase Stigall is into the game, number 33. He can handle the ball as well.
He can shoot it, too. Stigall can give him some points from the perimeter.
Baseline jumper is there for Woods. Cameron Woods getting about 15 minutes per game with a big jumper to make it a six-point game. Can Butler now get a stop?
Woods really squared up well on that jump shot.
Karnowski off the side of the backboard. Butler ball.
Good defensive play on the interior against Karnowski from out of Poland.
Jones spinning and just couldn't nudge it over the front of the rim, but he does draw the foul. ESPN's Journey to the Tourney is a season-long spotlight on games that will impact the tournament Thursday night. It's a battle of the Pac-12, UCLA and Arizona. UCLA losing at home today to Oregon. Oregon's beaten both of these teams already this season. ESPN's Journey to the Tourney, 7 Eastern Thursday on ESPN2 and also live on Watch ESPN.
That's not the way you want to go down and play Arizona after a loss at home. Oregon, Dana Walton doing a terrific job. UCLA won 10 in a row.
And we'll have the return match, Arizona at UCLA, as part of our Saturday primetime, our game day schedule. This is week one of 8 with Reese, Digger, Jay, Jalen Rose. We're going to go to NC State next week. We're going to Indiana, Kentucky, UCLA. Will any place be louder than this place?
This is unbelievable. We're at Fenway Park, man. Fenway, Wrigley. Really lifts them up on a defensive end. 36 years old. It's amazing when you look at his resume, what he's achieved in such a short period of time.
And how many so-called bigger programs would love to have him. You can say the same about Mark Few for many years as well. But these are two outstanding coaches, both very happy with the outstanding programs that they're coaching.
You don't mess with happy, as Jimmy V said.
That's right.
Both guys said, we are happy.
Eric Fromm has checked in for Butler. Jones turns it over, stolen away by Pangos.
Oh, Jones was up in the air. That's a no-no right there.
David Stockton, son of John, into the game for the Zags. And right now, Sam Dowell is taking this thing over.
The Dowell Show. It's the Dowell Show on national TV, baby. He's got his little show going on right now. I met Stockton's mother in the lobby of a hotel. Got a picture with her. Said, John right now cannot be here. He's coaching.
Dunham trying to draw the foul, did not. Jones with the offensive rebound, comes up short.
John is coaching his daughter right now. His son can pass the ball, you lay a screen, he'll find you.
So John Stockton actually coached Mark Few's son, AJ, for a couple of years. And Coach Few not home for AJ's birthday, turned 13 yesterday.
He said, we'll celebrate tomorrow, AJ. He's going to celebrate tomorrow for you. And there's nothing to like to bring to you better than a big W football game.
Good show by Karnowski. Jones. The handoff to Stigall.
Oh, nice little set right there.
And Dunham buries the corner three.
Nice job to throw into the corner by Dunham. That is great. He goes for an offensive set. Coaches do a marvelous job at the Butler and for Gonzaga. Really a pleasure watching well-coached teams play as a team.
Dee Landrietti short on the jumper. Butler ball.
You really like that name, man. You can call that name all day, man. Dee Landrietti.
Stigall.
Wow, look at that way.
Yes.
Are you serious? He shot off of downtown. Indiana, man, from Indianapolis. He shot off of Palomino's restaurant.
Zags trying to quiet the crowd. Dower again.
He won't.
Timeout on the floor. A run by Butler. Rodney Clark, the first guy up off the bench, congratulating his teammates who are knocking down jumpers from all over, Dickie B.
Wow. Nothing but nylon. This place is rocking and rolling. I can't even hear you, buddy.
And a timeout for Marlin with 18 seconds to go in the score, 5 turn of the 30. He's dribbling around 10 seconds, 9 seconds. Bobby Clark dribbling 6 seconds. Clark going down, jump, shoot, send the circle, score!
By Bobby Plump that won a state title here in this building in 1954 is the shot that inspired the movie Hoosiers. Bobby Plump, Jimmy Chidwell, Mylon Hickory. This building, as Shannon mentioned earlier, was the largest college basketball arena in the United States when it was built in 1928. Butler defeating the Irish in the first game back in 1928. It's a national historic landmark. Sixth oldest active building and the oldest floor. This is the original floor from 1928.
Wow. Was that Digger's first game?
No, it was his second year. Did you see the guys in the Hickory uniforms, the Hickory jerseys on game day this morning?
Bobby Plump, he has Plump's last shot, rush run.
Bobby Plump was a part of game day this morning, went out on the court and took a shot from the spot from where he hit the shot in 54, left it just a little bit short this morning.
Dennis Hopper, Gene Hackman, what a movie, it's my favorite.
Oh, what a great movie. Fromm as Olynyk has checked back in, Dower's gone to the bench. A missed three by Andrew Smethers. A guy who just lights it up in practice and is right on the cusp. Brad Stevens feels to become a major contributor for Butler. Harris with a mismatch inside. Boy, is he a pull down low.
Well, he really is, and he utilizes his size. He can post people. He can go out to the perimeter. I tell you, another great asset of Butler. You don't get many transition layups against him. You're going to have to execute your half-court game.
And Butler considered one of the most physical teams in the nation on defense. They're not the tallest team in the world, but they got a lot of strength, and they use it. Dunham whips a nice pass to Barlow.
Barlow wide open. Great screen down on the left side.
And Harris called for the offensive foul. That's going to be his second. Mark Few does not like the call. Hart's got two. Harris has got two. So he goes to the bench. And Dower checks back in.
Tim Kelly with the call. Have Tony Crisp on the game along with Bill McCarthy and Tim Kelly. There is some really quality basketball in the A-10. Really quality basketball. When you go up and down that conference today, St. Bonaventure beat Temple.
Now, we may have had a suspected or a possible elbow up high as we take a look. Watch Harris.
Right there.
And there it is right there. And the officials can decide if they feel it was an elbow up above the shoulder. It's a flagrant one. Two shots and the ball. That was more of a forearm than an elbow as the officials have a look at it and decide if it deserves any further penalty or if it's just a foul. Harris didn't think there should be any kind of a foul call at all. Now the officials discussing whether it should be a flagrant one.
You know, both clubs really right now on a win streak, 12 in a row and 8 in a row.
And no flagrant one, just a personal foul on Elias Harris. But it is a big loss for the Zags with him sitting down with two. As you mentioned, though, they've got a ton of depth.
They have depth. They're as deep as any team in America. They can really rotate people on the floor to make up for any foul trouble.
So Harris on the bench with two. Butler ball down by three. Dan Shulman, Dick Vitale, Shannon Spake of the game. Day gang with you here at historic Hinkle Fieldhouse in Indianapolis.
Going a little full court pressure. Got to post up to the middle.
And they get it over.
Good diagonal pass.
They've got him a big part of this Butler team as a true freshman.
Trying to get Smith a little involved. Going to rotate him to the box. Number 44.
Barlow trying to shake Stockton. Now Marshall from the baseline.
He's a veteran player. He can give you points. He's also an explosive athlete. They are so well drilled. Always looking for the good shot. In fact, he told us before the game, one of our unbelievable rules, better shots. We have to take good shots.
Olynyk misses inside.
He had a great shot right there. He go up strong enough. Olynyk was really terrific post position. Spacing is so important to Butler. You watch the good spacing, 15 to 17 feet apart, eliminates help.
Dunham, just a sliver of space, and he buries a three.
He's a typical Hoosier shooter, man. That kid has been shooting the jumper. Look at their execution. They don't convert. Had two layups in a row, the last two possessions.
One by Olynyk, one by Dower. Butler with the
momentum. Nothing like shooting that three to give you some
momentum. Trying to take down a terrifically talented Gonzaga team without Rodney Clark, their leading scorer, better than 16 a game.
They sent a message loud and clear how good they were to beat that Indiana team, as that is a quality Indiana team.
And Gonzaga's had a brutally tough schedule as well. They've beaten team after team as Marshall fouls Olynyk. And we're going to a timeout with 7:10 to play. Excitement tonight and a little bit of excitement here on this court during game day this morning, where Kevin Schwartz, one of Butler's biggest fans, knocked down a half-court shot to win himself a big pile of change. He'll join us when we come back.
He got it with one!
What a night so far here at Hinkle Fieldhouse, with the Butler roaring back to take a two-point lead over Gonzaga. And what excitement there was this morning at game day for a certain junior here at Butler, Kevin Schwartz, who broke an 0-for-32 drought hitting the half-court shot, the State Farm Challenge. Congratulations. What did that feel like?
Oh, it was amazing.
Yeah?
I practiced with the women's team here, and after every practice, all of the guys shoot half-court shots for fun. We have contests, so I'm pretty comfortable with that shot. And I knew when I put it up, it was going in.
Really?
I wanted to do everybody to make sure I got the ball first.
Nice.
Tell you what, he's got some swag. You talking about that? He was comfortable. He said, "I was comfortable shooting a shot from there."
Now, here's the best part of the story. You had a State Farm Challenge. You win 18,000, right?
Yeah.
Tell us what you told the guys this morning. What's the first thing you're going to do with the money?
Well, I'm going to first pay off my Maui debt, because I flew out there to watch the Bulldogs play in the Invitational.
How's that?
And then it was great. If you watch the Rodney shot from the Marquette game, I'm right behind the bench.
I believe we have that video. We'll show that when we get a chance.
Big man on campus, baby. You're going to be big man on campus.
I love it here. It's great.
How many text messages have you gotten today?
I was over like 150 at some point.
What about followers on Twitter?
Got another 100. So.
Tell us a little bit about coming to watch as Dunham leaves the three a little bit short, a long rebound, and a loose ball to the Zags. Tell us what it's like for this to be the home court of your basketball team.
Oh, this is one of the most historic venues in all of basketball, college, pro, high school. The state of Indiana is phenomenal when it comes to basketball. When it's packed like this and everybody's going crazy.
On the court right there, Smith. I tell you what, Danny, you hear what he speaks? He's taking my job. This kid has got potential. John Warhawk, do you hear about this? This guy's got potential.
Butler back on top. Just over 6 minutes to go in the first half. Is today the first time you actually took a shot on the court in this building?
Oh, I've taken a couple shots on this court because we practice every day in here with the girls. And every once in a while, I'll scoot my way in here with my own ball and take some, but it's always a blessing to be able to come in here and shoot, because it's such an amazing place with so much history.
Olynyk ties the game at 24.
Taylor Olynyk had a great move right there. That reverse drop step, taking the ball to the goal. One of the most improved players in America. He was on redshirt last year.
Yeah.
Scout team. Mark Few said he's going to light us up.
And Mark Few said he improved his body, improved his game, improved his outlook on the game. Let's go back to Maui, as Kevin Schwartz was talking about, and take a look at that shot, that miracle shot that Rodney Clark made to beat Marquette. Keep an eye on Clark. But there's Kevin right there. There's our guy. Up goes the shot. Butler wins the game. And it's madness in Maui. You've had a good year.
It's been great. I've had a good career.
Thanks very much. Congratulations. Thanks for joining us.
Let's look to the future.
Yeah.
Go Dogs.
Kevin Schwartz, a junior, risk management and insurance major, but a guy having a good day. Think of the half-court shot, $18,000 richer after the shot this morning.
You know what I like about it? He's got a lot of good school spirit. You can feel it.
And we got a good game going here. As Roosevelt Jones gives Butler the lead.
That's Jones' greatest strength. Be able to get in the blue area and attack the basket in the 3-second area.
Dower It won't stay down. Jones with a rebound.
You talk about Jones. He's defined very simply. Toughness.
You know, last year these two teams met in Spokane. The Zags won the rematch here this year. The series is not due to continue, but boy, it would be great. And these two coaches have so much respect and admiration for one another. Hopefully, this is a series that continues. These are two of the best, as you said, forget the term mid-major. These are two great programs, and how much fun is it to have them playing each other?
Well, Brad Stevens said if we want to do it, we want to continue.
Jones with the shot clock running down, called for the offensive foul.
He dipped that shoulder in right there. Good call by the officials. Brad doesn't like it, but he definitely dipped his shoulder in. Take a look right here. See that shoulder, the left arm? You nod your head. Yeah. Wow. You're going to be a seamer. I think you could be a great seamer.
Pangos taking the charge. Gonzaga leading early. Butler coming back and starting to knock down some outside shots. And they get a two-point lead as Fromm will check into the game.
You know, I think one of the keys right now, if you're Brad Stevens and you're a Butler fan, is the tempo. Right now, their tempo, they're not allowing them to get up and down the floor. You very rarely see the number game in favor of Gonzaga. 3-on-2, 4-on-2.
Gonzaga averaging better than 80 points per game. They are one of the highest scoring teams and one of the best shooting teams in the nation. This guy's a big reason why, as Olynyk finally gets one to go. 6 points now for Olynyk.
He has really developed an inside post presence. In fact, he's the first player at Gonzaga to go 30-30 two consecutive games since Adam Morrison did it.
Back in 2006, Olynyk from Kamloops, British Columbia, was mostly a perimeter player in high school, even though he's a seven-footer, but as we mentioned, getting much more comfortable playing inside this year.
I used to love watching Adam play. He was such a terrific college player.
From the offensive rebound, Woods the three. And Olynyk down to the board for the Zags, and then fouled by Fromm.
Yeah, not a good foul right there. You're 94 feet away from the goal. It's okay to hustle, but you got to hustle intellectually. You got to hustle with some good IQ.
We are tied at 26 as we take you to the under four media timeout. And Kelly Olynyk, the reigning West Coast Conference Player of the Month, one of the most improved players in the country, 6 points on the night to tie it up.
It's way past big speech time. I've enjoyed spending the last few days with you.
Let's go out and win this for all the little shows that never had a chance to make it here.
I want to win it for me.
On three. One, two, three.
Get it! The best part is at the end of it, Jay Billis says, I'll make it, like the Jimmy Chit would line. And Brad Stevens says, let Jalen take the shot. And the guys are getting ready. They're out of the Hickory jerseys. They're back in the fancy clothes. And are getting ready for the UPS halftime report. Reese Davis, Jay Billis, Digger Phelps, Jalen Rose. Number one loses. What a finish that was in Louisville as Syracuse steals one in the closing seconds. Ohio State, Michigan State went down to the wire. Florida, so impressive today. Wichita State beating Creighton. Oregon winning at UCLA. A lot to talk about at halftime.
I'll tell you one thing. What a phenomenal day in college basketball.
Olynyk inside for two more. He's heating up. He's now got eight.
Nice little screen and roll right there. Olynyk rolls to the basket, catches, converts. Say one thing, though, in that Hickory lineup that we just had, I'd give the ball to Rose or Sonny Billis and tell Reese Davis to make the pass and Digger to get out of the way.
You can see the Bulldogs, they broke out some new uniforms for this game. They don't have their names on the back of the jerseys. They've all got the word Bulldogs written where their names normally are. Olynyk floats it up inside, and Dower, who's been terrific in the first half, draws the foul. Well, we got some great action coming your way on the holiday. Big Monday, four games on ESPN. Cincinnati, Syracuse. The Orange will move up in the rankings. Oklahoma State at Baylor, Georgetown and Notre Dame, and then Texas and Oklahoma. Big Monday presented by Bud Light.
Well, if I would go with my top three right now, my top four, I'd go Kansas four. Three, I'd go Syracuse. Two, I'd go Michigan. We saw them the other day. And based on the resume of Duke, Duke's got to be number one. And we'll see them as number one down in Miami on Wednesday.
A good Miami team. So you would drop Louisville, Indiana down to like 5 and 6.
I believe Louisville probably 5, Indiana 6.
tell you, Gonzaga at 8 here, if they can pick up a win in this kind of an environment on the road, they might move up a notch or two. Butler turnover. Lobby inside for Olynyk, and a foul going against the Bulldogs.
Hey, Dan, they're really trying to take advantage of Olynyk on the inside.
Here's a look at some of the closing moments in the Syracuse-Louisville game. Michael Carter-Williams with the steal, the run out, and the jam that gave the Orange the lead in the closing seconds. And they would, I believe, add one free throw after that and win 70-68, doing it without James Sutherland on the road against the number one team in the nation.
They beat a quality team, but Jim Boeheim's been such an unbelievable winner throughout his career. That's just another W in his...
Smith guarding Olynyk.
Boozer really broke down the last couple of possessions.
Two-man game. And Olynyk is tied up by Smith. The arrow will keep it with Gonzaga.
Well, Olynyk's gotten the best of Smith here thus far in the first half.
You can see the connection that he and Pangos have. They've been running that two-man game time and time again. Gary Bell to inbound.
And Pangos has the ability off that two-man game to step back and shoot the three. That makes it such a dangerous combination.
Olynyk out on the perimeter looking for help. Now finds Pangos.
They really try to get in Pangos' face, knowing how he can shoot that three.
Three to shoot. Olynyk a little bit short. Rebound down to Smith. Two minutes to go in a spirited first half here at Hinkle Fieldhouse.
It would really help them if they get some point production inside out of Smith. He had a solid game against Richmond.
How about a three from Smith?
Well, they need a second, Smith. And he puts some points on the ball. He says, forget about two. I'm going to step out and shoot the three.
That's his eighth made three-pointer in 25 attempts this season. Hart kicks it out to Pangos, who misses the three. And then we're going to have an over-the-back foul against Dunham.
Take a look right here to kick it out to Andrew Smith. Steps up, shoots the three with lots of confidence.
Olynyk to the bench, Karnowski back in, and Hart to the line, a former walk-on. More than half of his rebounds come at the offensive end. And Mark Few says with great affection and admiration, he doesn't care if he plays 1 minute or 20 minutes. Whatever helps the team, he'll go to Coach Few and say, maybe you should start this guy instead of me, get him going. Just a guy who does all the blue-collar things to help his team, but he just missed the front end of a big one-and-one.
Now you think about some of the great players that have come out of mid-major. I'm going to call my old Larry Bird team. Came out of French Lick, Indiana State. Think about guys like Stephen Curry down there, Davidson, Hershey Hawkins down Bradley, Karl Malone, Louisiana Tech, Keith Van Horn, Utah, Keith Lee, Memphis. That's a pretty good team.
Not bad. These two programs as Stigall hits a deep three.
Oh, you're right, Daddy. Yes, that's a deep three.
He went several weeks without scoring at all after the Indiana game until the Dayton game. But now with Rodney Clark, they need him. And the philosophy in the Butler program is next man up, next man in. And Stigall's doing his buddy Clark proud.
They need him in. They also need Dunham to make those threes. Have a cookie.
We're coming. Go ahead.
I'm bringing us cookies.
We got to come back.
Yes, sir. Right? We got to come back
this
here,
has been
baby.
Great. This has been a
I
lot
want
of
a bite
fun.
Of a cookie. I'm starving.
Well, so give us your review of Hinkle so far. Your first time here.
5+. I don't give it a 5. I give it a 5+. It is everything Wrigley and Fenway. Same scenario.
Gonzaga ball.
That cookie I give a 5+ too.
It's pretty good, huh?
Oh.
Eddie with the drive. Dower for three. What a first half for Sam Dower.
He's been brilliant off the bench. Brilliant.
He has. has almost half of Gonzaga's points. Dower averages 7.2 points in 18 minutes per game. He's got 16 already here tonight.
See, that's why they're so difficult to defend. You don't know who's going to break out for them. They have a number of guys. He told us before the game, we have at least 5 to 6 guys that can put 20 on the board.
Shot clock, game clock, just about bang on. So Butler will attempt to hold for a final look and attempt to take a lead into the half.
I think right now, tempo, edge, Butler. They love this kind of tempo.
And a timeout taken by Brad Stevens, who's asking the official where's the ball before he puts in his final play. Well, the pair of teams looking to stay atop their division will meet when David West leads the Indiana Pacers against Rudy Gay of the Memphis Grizzlies. NBA Special Edition presented by State Farm Monday at 1 Eastern on ESPN and also live on WatchESPN.com. They got a pretty good NBA team in this town, too, don't they?
What about the kid George? He's doing a great
job.
Yep. Should be an All-State. Yep. Should be an All-Star, rather. He's been absolutely sensational.
Remember, no Danny Granger. He's been injured this year, but the Pacers are still playing some great basketball. Butler and Gonzaga have both played some great ball here tonight. This one has been everything we could have hoped for and more. Historic Hinkle Fieldhouse and two terrific national power programs in a Gonzaga and a Butler, and the man of the night so far, perhaps somewhat of an unlikely candidate, has been Sam Dower, who has more than doubled his scoring average already.
You know, you look at the win streaks in the country and how Kansas hung on to beat Texas today, 15 in a row. Utah State is up there. Butler has 12 in a row. Creighton got beat today, so they're gone. Louisville had 11 in a row. Creighton, they're both gone. Watch VCU. They've won 11 in a row, and I'll tell you, Shaka Smart's got an outstanding team.
The first half comes to a close here at Hinkle with visiting Gonzaga clinging to a one-point lead over Butler, 33-32, after a great 20 minutes of action. Shannon Spake is with Butler coach Brad Stevens.
Coach, Gonzaga was able to get up about 9 points to start this game. What was the key in getting back that lead and keeping them in within your sight?
Well, their field goals that they made, with the exception of Pangos' three, were all twos. Ours were mostly threes, and so that kept us in the game. We didn't do a very good job guarding their interior, somewhat to be expected when you look at those guys, but we got to do a better job in the second half.
Kelly Olynyk, you've held him to 8, but Sam Dower has had 16. What adjustments?
Well, Sam Dower's hit jump shots. Kudos to him. You know, I think one of the things we got to do is make those a little bit harder, but you know, you got to give away something when you're undersized in there, and we're clogging the lane, and he's making shots, and so we're going to have to adjust.
Thanks, Coach.
Yep,
thanks.
All right, Shannon, thank you. 1 point game of the half here at Hinkle. Don't miss the second half from Indianapolis here tonight. But first, Reese Davis and the guys deliver the UPS halftime reports.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is brought to you by Wendy's. Now that's better. And AT&T, the nation's largest 4G network. AT&T, rethink possible.
It's small by today's standards, but if the only other field house you'd ever seen was a barn, and you came here to play for the title back when the Indiana State High School tournament was open, then it was big. Oh man, really big. Those days are gone, but the message of Hoosiers lives on in this National Historic Landmark. It reminds us from every rafter, through every window, of the values we share and the power of dreams. Since 1928 on this court, championships have been won. Hard lessons have been learned, lives have been changed. But the essence of the game will always be the same in Hinkle Fieldhouse.
Welcome back to Saturday Primetime, presented by DirecTV. Tonight's game also a part of My Home Court Week, our week-long celebration of the great college basketball arenas and venues around the country. This is one of them. If you weren't with us in the first half, this is Hinkle Fieldhouse. This is where Hoosiers was filmed, and this is where the game that inspired Hoosiers actually happened. The Milan Miracle, when they won the state championship in 1954. The Big O, Oscar Robertson, won state championships in this building in 55 and 56, and unbelievable first half, unbelievable atmosphere. What do you think is going to decide this game in the second half?
Well, I think it's going to come down to the free ball. There's no question. Right right now, when you look at Butler, the reason they're in the game, only down one, they made four more threes than Gonzaga. Second key factor, they've been able to control tempo, not allowing Gonzaga to go up and down the floor and get layups. And I think that's a major factor. I think if they can do that, they can come down a wire. This is a very talented Gonzaga team and a very physical Butler team.
Shannon Spake has some Gonzaga adjustments for the second half.
Yeah, Dad, Coach Few told me earlier today that Butler is the one team that can really frustrate you. He told his players earlier this afternoon that you have to approach them like you're sawing wood. It might take a while, but eventually you'll get there. He told me no frustrations at all in the locker room. He feels like his players have been very poised. His bigs have done a tremendous job. He just said he wanted to defend the Butler shooters a little bit harder.
Tell you one thing, Shannon, you mentioned the bigs. The kid Dower was sensational. 16 big points. That was a major plus for Gonzaga.
Only four Zags scored in the first half. Dower had all the bench points as Jones, and there it is, the floater, the shot put, whatever you want to call it, but that's a go-to shot for him.
Well, he loves to get in the blue area, that three-second area. You got to keep him out of there.
Olynyk into Harris, back to Olynyk. Follows his own miss. Butler ball.
Well, they were much more effective when Harris was on the floor. He got those fouls and had to go to the sideline, and that really hurt Gonzaga.
Barlow, former walk-on, operating as the starting point guard with the sharpshooter Rodney Clark out of the sprained neck. For Butler, Jones blocked from behind. The Zags have a chance for numbers. Harris to Olynyk.
They're going to get back so quickly.
Bell misses the jumper, and an over-the-back foul on Hart. Michael Hart picks up his third less than a minute into the second half.
Well, he's a hustle player right there, and he tried to make a hustle play, but he reached over. See, it was a great job right there in transition. It looked like they have numbers. Butler got back, squared off, and made them throw the ball back out to the perimeter for really a quick shot.
As you said in the first half, one team, Gonzaga, known more for its offense. One team, Butler, known more for its defense.
Yeah, they've won some shootouts this year offensively, Gonzaga.
Finds Marshall. Up and off the rim. Smith is stripped. Barlow hits the deck along with Pangos. It'll be Butler's ball.
All because of hustle. Diving on the floor. Scrapping, clawing, making it happen. College basketball, what a day today. Go to Syracuse and Louisville game. Think about Michigan State, Ohio State. And now right here, Gonzaga. Look at the hustle. Are you kidding me? That's a walk-on, baby. He busted his gut to earn a scholarship.
Hit a big three earlier tonight and had the game-winning shot of the win over Indiana earlier this season.
And he played well against Dayton on the road. His mom and dad both are season ticket holders of Dayton.
Butler moving into the A-10 this year. Tougher league for them. Bigger bodies. Picked sixth preseason. But they're on their way, it looks like, to another great year, especially if Kellen Dunham keeps knocking it down.
He is a shooter, man. You can just see the release, the form, the way he squares the body. What an environment. What an atmosphere. We're getting paid for this, Dan Schumer. Look at this.
Barlow with a steal, and then he lost the ball out of bounds.
Little communication, tough to communicate and hear each other, but he had a trailing. He had Marshall trailing with a little hook pass for a layup.
And not only did he lose the ball out of bounds, he was also called for a charge on the play, even though he'd already lost the ball when he ran over Pango. So Barlow with a turnover and a foul, and here come the Zags down by four.
What a story when you think about Brad Stevens, Eli Lilly, pharmaceutical. Unbelievable.
Sixth season as the head coach. These are two of the three winningest coaches. Another great battle. And Barlow forces the turnover.
I mean, that kid, it becomes contagious. That's what they were talking about. Mark Few was telling us before the game how hard they play, how they're so physical, so tough. They really buy into all the things that have happened since 2006 when they won the NIT championship, a significant win over a good Gonzaga team.
Olynyk with a steal. And Harris, boy, is he clever and tricky around the rim.
Runs the court really well. Nice pass by Olynyk. That's how you win. But that win was significant in 2006. That sort of gave them the kickboard to start this run. In fact, that was a win. Gonzaga beat the good North Carolina team in the semifinal.
DeLandrietti is back in for Hart for the Zags. Battle of the Bulldogs, Butler and Gonzaga.
Have we took a picture?
We took pictures with the mascots.
Yeah.
With blue two and blue three, yeah. Jones is called for the travel.
Where's blue one? I stumped you. We want to send our sympathies out to Earl Weaver's family and to Stan Musial. I know you're a baseball aficionado.
Two legendary figures. I mean,
how many hits? Come on, how many hits?
3,630. What a good fact. 331, I think. Good fact about Stan Musial. 3,630 hits, 1,815 on the road, 1,815 at home. It is cool. Stan Musial dying today at age 92. Earl Weaver dying at age, I believe, 83. Two legendary figures in baseball. Our sympathies to their families and to the Cardinal and Oriole families as well.
I say thank you for all the memories and all the great times. You got a chance to do baseball. So foul on the inside.
Yeah. And Eddie will go to the line. Eddie is from the Ivory Coast. Harris, as we mentioned, is from Germany. Pangos and Olenek are both from Canada. Pangos from Newmarket, Ontario. Olenek from Kamloops, British Columbia.
And he's a tremendous athlete. Some say the best athlete on the team.
And Karnowski is from Poland. They have five international players. And Tommy Lloyd, one of their assistants, gets all the credit from Mark Few for scouring overseas tournaments, international tournaments, and finding great international players. And once one, two, three of them have a great experience, the word spreads, and
absolutely,
they end up attracting more international players.
Well, it's a great place to play as well. You got a tremendous environment here, but down at the Kennel, it's special out there in Spokane. One of the biggest fans they have is Judd Hiepko, who coached Magic Johnson, one of my favorite players of all time.
Yeah, Mark Few says he'll get a phone call from Coach Hiepko tomorrow to discuss the game, break it down, tell him where he can improve.
He knows basketball. Let me tell you, listen when Judd speaks.
Dunham, a deep one.
He got fouled. I mean, their range is unbelievable. I mean, that's not a three-point shot. That's almost like a five.
Olenek called for the foul. Three free throws coming for Dunham, who just about knocked this down as well.
Look at that range. I mean, way beyond the three line.
Boy, does this kid play with a lot of composure and confidence as we check in with Shannon Spake again.
Yeah, Dan, Coach Stevens told me today that Dunham is a game changer. When his shots go in, the players on this team know what a difference he can make. He also said he's a very humble guy, so putting him in the lineup was very easy.
A great free throw shooter, but he missed the first one here. Dunham came into this game at 93% on the season. He makes two of three here.
This game may come down to the free throw line, the way it looks right now. So I think it's important for Butler to have that lead because you don't want to have to play at a faster pace and try to catch them. You play at your pace right now. Look at the help inside.
They swarm Olenek and take it away.
Great help from the guards, reaching in, causing that deflection. Talk so much about this building, named after Tony Hinkle, Hall of Fame coach.
Originally known as the Butler Fieldhouse, Hinkle coached basketball here for 41 years, also coached baseball and football.
In those days, you had to do it all.
Yep. And a foul going against the Zags, much to the dismay of Mark Few. We'll go to our first media timeout here for the second half as Butler continues to hang on to a narrow lead.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is brought to you by Wendy's. Now that's better.
Welcome back to Hinkle Fieldhouse. A great game between a Gonzaga and a Butler. You're looking at Tommy Lloyd, the assistant coach for the Zags, who, as we mentioned, Mark Few credits with getting the vast majority of all these great international players that have been such a big part of the Gonzaga program. Shemek Karnowski, a freshman from Poland, who they saw when they were scouting an international tournament, and he was playing against Kevin Pangos, who's from Newmarket, Ontario. Right around the corner from me, don't you know, Dickie B.
All these Canadians are unbelievable.
Everywhere. A little further further away, another Canadian, Kelly Olynyk.
I thought it was a hockey state country rather. It's unbelievable. Hey, hockey's back.
Hockey's back. Guy Landrietti from the Ivory Coast, and Elias Harris, who's had such an outstanding career from Germany. Of course, Robert Sacre is now playing with the Lakers, another Canadian. He was part of the Gonzaga program last year, and they can't compete to a certain degree for the same kids. You know, they're not competing against, generally speaking, Duke, Carolina, Kansas, UCLA, places like that. So they're stretching the borders. They're looking everywhere they can for great players. Butler also typically does not compete for players against the likes of Indiana and so forth. They get players that Brad Stevens said yesterday consider lower Power Six conference teams, other big non-Power Six conference teams. Yet both of these coaches, in a very different ways, because they're such outstanding communicators and outstanding coaches, they've built two of the strongest programs in the country.
Well, they built those players into a team concept, and they get them to understand their roles, their strengths, their weaknesses. The one thing that's off the resume, and I'd love to get it at Gonzaga, with all their success on the Mark Few, they haven't been able to get to that Final Four.
One Elite Eight, a total of five Sweet 16s. Well, the Zags are on the glass, but can't finish after the miss by Harris. Butler with the ball and a four-point lead.
Got a matchup on their perimeter. They made eight threes tonight. You got to take away the three on Butler. Make them bound it inside. I know Smith can be a factor there, but obviously they got a good matchup with Olynyk on him.
Jones doing some ball handling again. Lobs it up. Woods out of bounds.
Yeah, tough play right there. Really didn't have a good angle.
And Brad Stevens in disbelief saying Woods passed that ball away before it came down and hit the court.
You mentioned the Elite Eight. That was 1999. That was the year that Connecticut won it all. Connecticut actually beat them in the Elite Eight.
Pangos using the screen, finds his buddy Olynyk. Crowd wanted to travel. Stockton saves it deep in the corner. Dower with good patience misses the turnaround, and Smith the rebound.
Wait, no, Dower was 6-8. The first half had 16. It's going to be tough to match that performance. He's long. He's got long arms. He can shoot the ball. And I like what Brad Stevens said to Shannon. Hey, we're going to make him. They have to shoot. Something has to give. If he's going to make that jump shot, so be it.
And away from the ball, a Gonzaga foul. It'll be on David Stockton. ESPN College Basketball is available live anytime, anywhere on your computer, tablet, or smartphone at WatchESPN.com and with the Watch ESPN app. Dan Shulman, Dick Vitale, Shannon Spake of the Game Day Gang here with you at Hinkle Fieldhouse. And what a fun night this has been so far. Butler leading Gonzaga by four. Butler playing without Rodney Clark. It's outstanding guard out with a sprained neck after a scary-looking injury last week at Dayton. But he's okay. Should be back soon, but unable to play tonight.
Trying to jam that pass in. Wasn't available. Rotating, playing man-to-man defense. Gonzaga to play a little zone here tonight. Both coaches have so much poise on the sideline. And you can see the respect they have for their players. They've earned that respect. You earned that by success.
Olynyk to the bench. 85 points in his last three games, but with some foul issues tonight. And this one's going to go against Eric Fromm of Butler.
But 11 years in a row, they won the West Coast Conference. Last year, that edge went to St. Mary's. Yep. He has a heck of a team of Randy Bennett. They beat them earlier this year.
There's some good basketball being played out west. We were talking about, with Mark Few, about the West Coast Conference and St. Mary's and BYU.
Well, Mount West.
Mount West. How about Larry Scheid in Wyoming with a 13-point win over San Diego State earlier tonight?
Colorado State had a big win over UNLV.
Harris the miss, the follow, and the finish. He is an absolute load for a guy his size.
Yeah, he creates all kinds of matchup problems because he can play a number of positions. Yep. They've done a great job, when I say great job defensively, Butler, on Pangos. They haven't allowed him to get looks for that three, and he's a real sharp shooter.
Stigala hit a couple of big shots in the first half. Back in for Butler. And David Stockton just got called for the foul. And I think Stigall got him. I don't think Stockton did anything. I think Stigall ran right into him and lifted up Stockton's arms to draw the foul.
I agree with you right there. He got away with that one. Watch Stigall right here. Yeah, he didn't do a thing.
Yeah, Stigall initiated the contact and got the foul call.
Talk about genes, huh? He should be able to pass the ball. His dad was as good as it gets on a screen and roll with he and Karl Malone.
Gonzaga very deep into its bench. Drew Barham, a transfer from Memphis, has been in for a while. And now Kyle Dranginis, number three, a redshirt freshman, into the game for the first time. Jones muscles it up and in.
As you said earlier, he's like a bull, man. He spotted the gap in that 2-3 that rotated out of the man, and he got right into the gap with that stretch.
Barham hit three threes in the Zags' last win over Portland Thursday night. Harris fouled and will head to the free throw line.
Nice offensive rebound by Harris. Nobody put a body on him. Take a look at Jones right here. He spots the gap, and that's just pure strength that he can get that up on the glass and get the conversion. Hey, both these clubs, if you don't think they're going to be a factor come tournament time, forget about it. Both of them are going to be major factors. There's a lot of good basketball being played out in West, as you mentioned earlier. You think of the West Coast Conference with some good quality teams. You think about that Mountain West. What about Boise State? His former assistant doing a great job. Mark Fuse, Leon Rice.
And a couple of free throws for Harris. With Dower not as much of a factor here in the second half. And Olynyk sitting on the bench with three fouls. Harris might be the guy who has to try to keep Gonzaga in this in the meantime.
Jones is grabbing his right by his knee. I don't know what's up.
Barlow absorbs a bump, gets it over.
As Jones grabs the ball.
Yeah, well, he is grimacing a little bit. You're right.
He's dragging that right leg.
Stigall. And it's going against Gonzaga.
They're trying to match him for their physicality because they really came in all over their locker room is how physical Butler's going to play.
And it's already bonus time for Butler.
And that's going to be a major plus. Good free throw shooters.
Fromm at the line. Belling Smith. Dunham's on his way back in for Jones. They'll get a look at whatever it is that's ailing him. Mark Few said it before the game. You know, if somebody's hurt, if somebody's in foul trouble, does that ball look like it was taken off the rim by Harris?
Looked like a little interference down to me.
Break there for the Zags, it looks like. Dower inside with a strong move.
That was a big-time move by Dower. He really exploded to the basket. Good reverse, took it up strong. Had to rotate back out of the man on the zone. 2-3.
Stigall. And the rebound down to Dranginis.
You want to shoot that ball too quickly.
Pango's trying to get going. Harris from beyond the arc. Stigall the rebound.
Yeah, foul
and,
right
foul. And it's number four on Hart.
Not a good foul. I mean, he's 80 feet from the basket. Come on, Dan. Even a dummy like me could figure that out. You're supposed to say you're not a dummy. Oh, gee, I don't write your script for you.
Was the ball the cylinder? Sure looked like it was. As Harris looked like he took it off. Dower with a strong move at the other end. 1-point lead, Butler. Built in 1928 at the time, the largest basketball arena in the country, then known as the Butler Fieldhouse, now known as Hinkle Fieldhouse, after legendary Butler basketball, baseball, and football coach Tony Hinkle. Hinkle Fieldhouse hosted over 40 years of Indiana high school state championships when everybody played in the same class. As we mentioned, Hoosiers filmed here. The Milan Miracle happened here. Oscar Robinson won two state championships here. Tony Hinkle, his name now on this building, and as you said, back then he did everything, and he did everything very well. 41 years as the head basketball coach here at Butler, winning a national championship back in the 20s. Brad Stevens has taken this program right to the cusp of a national championship on two occasions, something that a few years ago would have seemed, if not impossible, certainly unlikely, but they've done it, and now you overlook Butler, you do it at your own peril.
I'm going to tell you this. In my 34 years at ESPN, I think it's the greatest achievement I have ever seen. The fact that they can go Butler to the final game of the NCAA tournament consecutive years. I can't think of a better achievement for a school when you think about their stature at that time. Hey, I'll give you this. The largest crowd ever at Butler, 1954. Butler against Rio Grande. Who is Rio Grande? They had a guy by the name of Bebo Francis, who once scored 113 points in the game.
Janginis to miss, and a strong rebound way above the rim by Smith. And Brad Stevens tells us he's a better athlete than he gets credit for. He says, quote, he's got bounce, and we saw some bounce right there.
He steps out, he can shoot the ball, as we saw it earlier.
He has hit a three tonight, his eighth of the season. Dunham hasn't been shy.
They come right up on Dunham now. They know he's a shooter. He's going to have to work a little bit more on attacking the basket as he gets a little further in his career. This guy will attack.
Marshall from the baseline. Got it.
Created by the penetration of Jones. He's what you call a stat stuffer. I mean, Jones is the kind of guy, you look at him, he looks unorthodox, he looks like a football player, but he gets results. And isn't it about results?
It is about results. Harris, no. Butler ball.
This Butler team, man, is ferocious, tenacious. What a great competitive environment, and two teams really clawing and really getting after each other. Execution so important in a half-court sets.
Dunham. He was looking to draw the foul there as much as make the shot. Didn't do either, but back come the Zags.
See, here they want to run. They want to run.
Pangos, that's a big shot in his repertoire as he banks it in from about 12 feet away.
See, he's really improved so much that he's more than just a jump shooter or a passer. He can now put the ball on the floor and score.
The deficit is two for the Zags as we have passed the midway point of the second half.
And it weaves up on top. That's fake. Great fake.
And a block is the call.
Terrific triple threat position. Catch the ball, face, square your body. Defense reacts to you, beat them off the bounce. I was working with my grandkids on that move the other day. Triple threat position.
Elias Harris called for the foul, his third. So Hart's on the bench with four. Harris is in the game with three. Olynyk is on the bench with three. Now here comes Olynyk back into the game for Dower.
Gotta make that. But my grandkids are watching, Ryan, Connor, and Jake. I always tell you guys, catch, face, and you can do three things. You can drive, you can pass, or you can shoot. When I played, I wanted to shoot.
misses by Smith. And Harris down with the rebound. If I know their mother, those boys are in bed already. Dranginis left open.
Oh, that was in and out.
And Fromm with a good rebound.
Give us another guy if you give him that three.
Well, Dunham in constant motion with and without the basketball, always moving.
He reminds me of a version of Hulse at Indiana.
Bigger though.
Yeah, much bigger.
Fromm. And look at the rebound and the finish. Great hustle by Stegall to feed Smith.
Not only did he hustle Stegall and get that ball, he had the intuition and the know-how of where his teammate was and recognized him immediately. Oh, they're rocking and rolling here, baby. The Heagle is exploding.
It is the battle of the Bulldogs here tonight. Gonzaga and Butler. And what a game it's been with the Butler Bulldogs holding a four-point lead right now. Brad Stevens said without Rodney Clark, somebody would have to step up. He wasn't quite sure who it would be. And it turned turns out the Smith dunk, which started with the Stegall offensive rebound, Chase Stegall has been as important a player tonight as anybody wearing the white jersey.
Yeah, he made a couple of big threes, but that play was a hustle play. That becomes contagious, comes off from the weak side, gets the offensive rebound. Take a look at the deuce versus the three. Made as many threes as twos tonight. They knew they had to do that to offset the size differential when you look at the front line of Gonzaga.
And Kellen Dunham, the freshman, has made four of them. Andrew Smith, the big guy's made one. Stegall has made a couple, and Alex Barlow has made a three as well. They have spread it around much more so than Gonzaga really has. Stockton and Pangos in the backcourt together.
And there's two factors they're leading. Number one, their defensive effort. And two, control and tempo in a game. Just eliminating as many transition opportunities for Gonzaga.
Butler's won eight in a row. They're 15-2. Gonzaga is 17-1. Excuse me, Gonzaga has won eight in a row. They're 17-1. Butler's 15-2. Two outstanding teams. Harris with a slam, and what a find by David Stockton.
I'll tell you one thing. He puts a mini version of his daddy right there. An incredible pass. Great vision, great feel. Knew where his teammate was. Watch this now. He spots his teammate. Hey, I'm making like my dad did. Look at that. There's the best pass to Harris. That's Stockton to Malone right there. That's Stockton to Malone.
That is beautiful. Beautiful stuff.
Beautiful execution.
And credit to Harris for moving and cutting on the play, knowing that Stockton would find it, but he misses a free throw.
Well, I'll tell you, I think they work on that stuff in practice. That offensive efficiency is no accident.
Gonzaga is third in the country in field goal percentage this year. They're in the top 10 in points per game, but they're being held significantly under their scoring average tonight by the Butler Bulldogs.
See right here, you take time off the clock with each possession. Make sure you get a good shot. Slows down their explosive offense.
Jones into the chest of Olynyk, no call, and Jones finishes strong.
That guy is a bull, man. He finds a way to get to the rack. He is a winner. That's how they define him, as a winner. Toughness.
Brad Stevens says he gives the team belief. When they need a tough play to be made, Jones is the one who will make it.
Look at him as playing a left. He's giving up all kinds of size in terms of height.
Yep.
And he has the physical presence.
Harris inside draws the foul.
This series must continue.
Must.
These two must play. They must play. Just like Kentucky should be playing Indiana, these two must play.
And let's be the first to tell our boss, Jay Levy, if they play, we want to be there, right?
Yeah, we want to be there. No doubt about it, Jay.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is presented by DirecTV. Don't just watch TV, DirecTV. Call 1-800-DIRECTV. And in part by Lowe's. Lowe's. Never stop improving.
And welcome back to historic Hinkle Fieldhouse here in Indianapolis, the site of so many great moments, real basketball moments and movie basketball moments as well. Some say Hoosiers is as good a sports movie as there's ever been.
Well, it's my first one. I love it. I mean, it's my first. Number one, if you ask me what my favorite movies are, I have to have number one, Hoosiers. It's basketball, too, and it was so dramatic. I also like a number of other ones as well. Certainly Blindside was a great one. I love it. There they are.
Miracle.
Hey, the Miracle, Herb Brooks. That was
Hockey, huh?
Oh, Rocky Raging Bull, Jake LaMotta, Ryan Saul, Gale Sayers, Ryan, Tears, baby, Tears.
Field of Dreams? Field of Dreams?
Yeah, baseball, Field of Dreams has to be up there, but a Wolf Dwarf as well. But those are my favorites. I've watched A Miracle, I don't know how many times.
Same.
That was so special. Blindside, I love. Blue Chips, too. I was in Blue Chips. He's got game. I was in Elwood, too. Cameo, little cameo.
Harris knocks it down. This building opened in 1928. That is Jean Wildman, Butler's oldest fan. She was here when the building was built. She was at Butler games in 1928 when this building opened, and she is still here now.
She was there when Dinger coached here. That
yes.
First game? She was
here. They beat Notre Dame. That's right.
They beat Notre Dame. Beat you, Dinger. She was here.
Butler's greatest fan. 2-point game, 7:15 to go.
2-3 zone now, out of the man. They try to find, out of the zone, they make sure they try to find Dunham.
Marshall will take the 17-footer.
got a good shot right at the foul line area, right behind the front two in that 2-3 setup. Good stock to head up all the time. Great vision, great feel, savvy. Oh, look at a mismatch right out here. They have a switch.
Looking inside for Harris. Left hand, no. Olenek down with a rebound and is tied up. The arrow will keep it with the Zags.
Tell you one thing about Olenek, he plays hard. He really plays hard.
He and Mark Few mutually agreed that a red shirt would be the best thing last year because of the presence not only of Elias Harris, but also Robert Sacre, who is now in the NBA. So Olenek went to work on his body, and also they almost made him an assistant coach. They made him sit on the bench and chart things and see the games from a coach's perspective. And Olenek would say things to Mark Few like, why aren't they doing that? And Mark Few said, well, now you understand how we feel when we say those things to you. And he's come back a more mature player and also a guy willing to bang inside a lot more than he did a couple of years ago.
You know, Sacre's getting some positive minutes now for the Lakers.
Stockton, another beautiful find, and Olenek ties the game.
I'll tell you, Stockton's just a coach's dream, the way he passed the ball. So unselfish. We're going to have a ball burner. We've got the last 6 minutes. We've got a tie game.
You ain't kidding.
They haven't lost here at home yet, Butler. And they got a challenge on their hands for this outstanding Gonzaga team. Now you get down to where shot selection is so vital. The right people shooting the ball.
Marshall back to Jones. Jones again.
It's amazing how he gets to the basket. He uses his body so well to seal off the defense.
13 for the sophomore, Roosevelt Jones. 9 of them here in the second half.
This place is electric, man.
And Jones having to defend Harris on the inside.
Olenek trying to set a screen.
Stockton misses the three. Harris over the back.
I don't think there's any doubt about it.
Or was it? Which way is it going to go?
Well, it looked like he jumped right over his butt. I don't know what the debate could be.
And it is Harris, number 4.
I mean, I don't know what eye I can see that, climbing over the top. That's a big foul there because he's been important to that.
5.5 minutes to go.
Butler hasn't lost in about 2 months.
Butler's won 12 in a row. Gonzaga has won 8 in a row. Sam Dower's getting ready to check in.
Both lost to Illinois, and Illinois was playing so well, and had have really had a tough, tough time. What about today? You talk about the Big Ten. Wisconsin up beating goes to Iowa, gets beat by the Hawkeyes. Think about Iowa, Todd Lichtenreiter. Left here, went to Iowa. You don't mess with Happy. Jimmy D's favorite line.
Woods in for Butler, Dower in for Gonzaga. Marshall sits down, and Harris with 4 fouls sits down. And 1 of 2 from the line, kept alive and out of bounds off Woods, back to the Zags.
And that's really been a struggle for him, the free throw line. However, he's really improved the last few games. His Dayton, he went 8 for 12, and that's a big plus for him. Talking about Jones.
Olenek the screen. Gets the return feed.
Almost made a moving screen right there.
Backing down Jones, who got a piece of it.
I tell you, Jones is amazing. He's given away how many inches?
Jones is 6'4". Olenek is 7 foot.
So that's 8 inches. That Tommy XL figured that out. 4 from 12 is 8.
But Jones shaking up again. Paying the price.
Look at this here. He stays down. Waits till he brings down the ball. Makes contact with it. I love the intensity and emotion that both teams play with. That's all a reflection of pride and success of the programs. But you're not going to play. You're not going to play if you're not going to represent those coaches in a positive way.
Olenek misses the front end.
Take time off the clock. You don't want to slow down. Play within your offense, but you want a good shot. Good timeout.
Brad Stevens will use a timeout. Don't forget, there's more great college basketball action coming your way on the holiday on a Monday. 4 games here on ESPN. beginning at 3:30 Eastern time. Cincinnati taking on Syracuse, which pulled off a big win at number one Louisville today, so the Orange will move up in the rankings. Oklahoma State into Baylor, Georgetown against Notre Dame, the Irish barely surviving at home tonight, beating Rutgers, and then Texas and Oklahoma. Big Monday presented by Bud Light.
Well, you know, Notre Dame's had an incredible, as you look at the shows on that sideline, well, it's soap opera with Manti Te'o, which has been unbelievable. Jeremy Schaaf did a great job. I want to believe the young man that he had no part of that hoax. And I hope and pray that that's true.
Roosevelt Jones has to come out of the game. And what a big loss this potentially is for Butler with what he's done offensively and defensively, as Smith is now joined by Woods in the front court.
Something tells me we're going to see him back on the floor. There's something about that kid. Step out on the screen. Oh, Smith wide open, so he can step back and shoot that three. Oh, what a great rebound. What a terrific offensive rebound. I mean, that was significant right there. Allows you to take some time off the clock. It gives you another opportunity to score. Two factors. I mean, he just went to the rim. Look at the poise right there of Brad Stevens.
Smith shot it, knew he missed it, followed it, and got it back.
Well, nobody blocks out, Dan. I hope you block out when you go play in your games in Israel. I think he's going to coach you.
He's going to coach us.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. We've seen some great rebounds by Butler. Stegall had a huge offensive rebound a little bit earlier in the game. Smith with one out. Stegall looks like he might have taken a shot to the face or something.
See, when you're an offensive rebounder like that, we've said it time and time again, that means you play aggressive basketball. Guys that stand around and watch, they don't win. You got to play aggressively.
Let's update our one-on-one tonight. Kelly Olynyk and Andrew Smith, the two big guys. Olynyk a little bit more of a factor offensively, but Olynyk's numbers down from his recent games when he's been absolutely tearing it up.
They have done a great job neutralizing them, but I think one of the reasons his numbers are down a little was the play of Dower. Dower getting 16.
Yep.
You can't have everybody scoring.
And Olynyk picked up a couple of fouls here in the second half, spent a few minutes on the bench. Butler with the ball and a three-point lead. We are in the last 5 minutes of regulation here at Hinkle Fieldhouse.
There's that zone. Foul line area is wide open behind the front two guys. You can slide a guy across that lane.
Marshall gets a good look and makes it a five-point game. The largest lead of the night for Butler.
Wide open. Marshall, a veteran player. Timeout by Mark Few, knows that they got to really lock it up now. This has been everything we anticipated and expected. Everyone. Look at Marshall, wide open by that foul line area. Wide open. Look at the rotation, kids.
And again, and you can't say this enough, Butler is playing without Rodney Clark, but that has not hurt the team. They are leading here tonight. Other guys are filling in for their outstanding guard. And boy, you talk about the sixth man. This place has it.
Darren, one thing I talked to Tom Green to get a little feel for Butler, and he said, let me tell you, Rodney Clark is a big, big out for him out of the game. He is such a
big
shooter, stretches the defense.
Meanwhile, Roosevelt Jones in more discomfort. He has been a tremendously important player for Butler tonight, especially in the second half at both ends of the court. So now they're playing without their leading scorer in Clark, and a guy that Brad Stevens really describes as their heartbeat. In Roosevelt Jones.
I like the way you're pounding your heart right there. You're pounding that heart.
Gotta get into it, Dickie Boy. Olynyk.
Oh, he stopped his dribble. Nice pass, though.
And Dower lays it in.
Great look by Olynyk. The two bigs at the inside. Dish the rock exceptionally well. Here we go to winning time. A three-point differential. Who leaves with an L? Two winning streaks at stake. Two teams forget mid-major. We talked about it earlier. Charter flights, million-dollar contracts for the coaches. This is big-time basketball.
Stegall off to Barlow.
And a head Smith missed him. They had him.
And a block on Olynyk. His fourth foul.
Look at him on his face. Can't believe it. He can't believe it either. I can't believe it. I can't believe it. That's a poor call right there. You have a right, Marfield. You have a right. That's life on the road.
One more look going to break. Olynyk with his fourth. Butler to the line when we come back.
back to Hinkle Fieldhouse, where Butler is currently up by three over Gonzaga. Roosevelt Jones, he was out of the game for about 5 minutes. The trainers were working on his right shoulder. They were applying Flexol underneath that shoulder blade. He was in a lot of pain. They just continued to do range of motion stuff. He walked over to Brad Stevens moments ago. The trainers gave the thumbs up. Roosevelt Jones nodded his head, so he will be checking back into the game.
All right, Shannon, thank you. So that is a big development for Butler. Jones has been so important at both ends of the floor in this game tonight for the Butler Bulldogs, who are leading by three. And Kyle Marshall going to the free throw line with 3:43 to go.
Marshall has two shots.
Some of these games come down to the free throw line.
Marshall, a 54% free throw shooter on the season.
Didn't look like it right there, the way he struck that. You saw Jones, who really struggles on the line. He's 5'8".
Stockton back in.
He's in for offense. Creating offense with his passing ability. Great vision.
Two.
Stats don't lie there, huh? They don't lie.
Long way to go. Stockton at the point. Pangos can play off the ball. Here comes the screen from Olynyk. They've run this a lot tonight.
I'll tell you one thing. They've done a great job negating the three of Pangos. He has had opportunities to shoot the three.
That time Smith gave Olynyk the three, but he chose not to take it. Stockton will, and he'll nail it.
Stockton got the three. Defense rotated over on Pangos, and he shot it with a lot of confidence, too.
He has had three or four
big plays.
Extraordinarily big plays. The numbers don't tell the story about Stockton tonight.
Right now, tempo. They've done a great job, Butler, to put themselves in a position to win this game with the way to control the tempo of the game, the pace of the game.
Marshall over Olynyk. Contact between Pangos and Jones. It's a hold on Pangos. Jones going to the line.
Pangos had no shot there. He had to hold because of the size. Look at Stockton now. He's squared up. He's at the three-point line, wide open. Tipples the twine, not from Manila, NBN.
Two free throws for Jones. Not a good free throw shooter, but as Dick mentioned earlier, improving. Better the last couple of weeks.
He's 5-for-8 thus far tonight. His shot puts the ball, you notice it? Very little rotation.
You hardly ever see him take a jump shot in the game. Most of his offense comes on runners, floaters, that kind of thing. It's not a comfortable-looking release at the free throw line. As you can see, he's only at 56%, but he was down in the 40s for a while. He was improved to get to 56.
He's a power player. He's a power player. He's good for 1-for-2. Going to go 2-for-4 in the last two trips to the free throw line, and that's not really good. Listen to this crowd. Listen to the Butler Fanatics. Oh.
Wide open, Olynyk misses the three. Out of bounds to Butler.
He was wide open, too open. He was thinking about it. That few 17-1, lost that one game at home to Illinois. Brandon Paul was sensational.
Mark Few subbing offense, defense. So Stockton out. Michael Hart back in. Hart's got four fouls. Olynyk's got four fouls.
Get man to man now. Come out of his zone.
Elias Harris, another Zag, has four fouls. Three players in the game with four for Gonzaga, none for Butler.
So Jones wants to put the ball on the floor. He's an attacker. Oh, he got banged. Jones got hit right there. No doubt he's going to go to the line.
Is it Hart? Or who was it? Pangos, maybe.
I think it was Pangos. He was moving without the ball, and he came over and laid a body on him. And now he's trying to be a little politician with Jordan Chris. I mean, there's no
right
doubt.
There. Yep.
I mean, come on now. Come on now. Then we'll get a better hit than that from the Ravens with Raven Lewis.
Stockton back in.
That's a big plus. He made the first one. Takes a little pressure away.
And Olynyk fouled by Smith.
Yeah, silly foul right there because now he stopped the clock. You don't let him take any time off to get points. They can get points without the clock moving.
The fourth on Andrew Smith.
As the former pharmaceutical marketing genius, now a basketball guru, and he keeps winning like he does. He's going to own the pharmaceutical company.
That's what happens when you win about 80% of your games, huh? Olynyk 81% on the season, 0-for-1 tonight.
He's got a nice stroke. He really has an excellent stroke. Has another year of eligibility.
Fourth-year junior, redshirt junior.
Tell you what a schedule they play, too. You check out their schedule, Gonzaga. It's unbelievable.
They're 5-0 against the Big 12 this year.
Yeah, right. They haven't played Kansas. They can still 5-0. Because right now, you look at the Big 12, I mean, it's all Kansas, basically.
One-point game.
Kansas State, too. We got to give them their game. Jones right now handles the ball well. 6'4". He's versatile. You can use him a number of ways. Trying to get some good spacing. That was a screen by Smith up on top.
Jones the lob. Over the head of Marshall. Boy, he had it too.
He was wide open. Wide open. Don't let them have that possession back. Look at that. He's smiling, but down deep, I know that's hurting. Especially in a one-point game. I mean, they would have been up three right there. Throw the ball anywhere near him. Look at the crowd rising for some defense now. This club lives off their defense, their physicality. You love seeing teams that really are tenacious, come after it, play so hard, play with passion, play with intensity, play with emotion.
Harris inside, and the Zags have the lead.
A terrific drive. Nobody rotated over. Harris got to the rack. Here we go, Mr. Sherman. It's going to be a mailbox masher.
But to borrow an old cliche, it's a shame somebody has to lose this game as Butler goes back on top, courtesy of Roosevelt Jones.
Roosevelt Jones, winner, W-I-N-N-E-R, a winner. He doesn't have a lot of finesse, he has all power, and he knows how to win.
Playing without Rodney Clark, and Jones playing through pain and injury here in this game, just keeps making play after play, as Elias Harris has done all night long for the Zags.
And as Harris splits the defense, he gets the score. And then Mr. Jones says, anything you can do, Mr. Harris, I can do better. And there it is, puts him up one. It looks to me, it's going to get down to who has the ball last.
They've each got 18 points tonight. Sam Dower is actually the highest scorer in the game with 20. For Gonzaga had 16 of them in the first half.
Hey, I'll tell you this right now, Dan. I got nowhere to go. Do you have anywhere to go?
I got nowhere to go.
What about five overtimes, Dan? I have no problem with that. Even though we don't get paid for overtime, but you know what? Let's have some overtime. This is fun.
Gonzaga off a win Thursday night at Portland. Had some mechanical issues with their plane, so they didn't get here until late last night. Didn't have a whole lot of time to prepare for this game. But what a game it's been, with a series just a couple of years these two teams have been playing each other. Hopefully it continues. They're both on long winning streaks. Both big-time programs battling into the final minute here at Hinkle. It'll be Harris. Now Pangos. Harris. Yes!
He's made two big shots in a row. Two big shots in a row.
7.5 seconds between the game clock and the shot clock.
Yeah, Gonzaga will get the ball back for sure for another possession, no matter what happens here.
It looks like Brad Stevens will let him play it out.
Smith inside. He's going to get free for them.
Barlow, the kid who hit the shot to beat Indiana, gives him the lead here.
And he's a walk-on who now finally has got himself a scholarship. But we said, who has the ball last, baby? And it's in the hands of the Zags now. Barlow down, as you said. That big shot against the Hoosiers. And here it is, the clear left side. A screen. Look at Smith did a phenomenal job of clearing out that side. I mean, watch Smith down there with that screen. Opened up that whole left side for Barlow to make that running shot off the glass.
No Rodney Clark for Butler. So many other players have stepped up tonight, whether it's Jones, whether it's Stegall, whether it's Barlow, and Butler's got the lead, but Gonzaga's got the ball.
Well, that's exactly what Coach Stevens told us before the game. He said, you get an opportunity, you got to take advantage of it, and some of you are going to get playing time and some opportunities.
All right, Dick. Gonzaga's out of timeouts. They've got the ball. 20 seconds left. What are they looking for? Are they going inside to Harris? Are they looking for Olynyk? What are they looking for?
I think you got to think about Harris and his drive and watch Olynyk on the offensive boards. So many times, games like this are won with the offensive rebound. So blocking out is vital. If you're in a huddle right now, you're Brad Stevens. You're talking about find your man and get a body on him. Don't allow him to have a lane to the glass for the offensive rebound.
Both coaches, the picture of calm.
You know, these two guys, Shaka Smart's another one. Yeah. These guys, so brilliant. Shaka only 35. Here we go. Hinkle is jumping. It's alive. Will it be alive in 20.6 seconds?
No timeouts for the Zags. Shot clock turned off.
They haven't lost at home yet, Butler. They haven't lost at home.
Stockton.
He can pass the ball. Now he's just going to find someone.
Bell. 8 seconds. Now Pangos.
Oh, great pass.
And he's fouled.
Good free throw shooter, too. Really good free throw shooter.
Boy, great ball movement, dude. Just about everybody out of touch.
Right there, good screen. Drive, kick it out. The screen is always the most dangerous guy. Lay the screen. People will lose their foot.
Olynyk made two just moments ago.
He has a good stroke, too.
And Brad Stevens is pointing up to the clock above the court, asking for some clarity about something.
That's more time. They have time. They certainly have time to get a good shot with 4.6. Oh, he strokes that ball, man. He really does.
Hart back in for defense. Marshall back in for offense for Butler. One free throw to give him the lead. Butler with two timeouts.
Got to put a little pressure on the ball. You don't want to run it right at the court that quickly. You want to take some time off that clock.
Emerson Campen comes into the game for the first time tonight. Another big body to just try and corral the rebound for Butler. And two huge free throws for Olynyk.
So put a little pressure on the ball. You don't want to get that ball up the court that quickly. They're leaving the guy on the baseline alone.
Campen looking for help. And a timeout called by Brad Stevens.
It's been everything as advertised being here. Two teams, they'll be a major factor come March Madness. And it all really, really counts. But right now, this has been one intense emotional battle. Well, right now, you got to get the ball up the court and then try it, obviously, and want to get a shot for Dunham. I think Dunham is a guy who wants to shoot the ball. He can shoot it. Where Jones has to penetrate and take too much time off the clock.
Now, you got 4.6 seconds. The clock doesn't start until the ball is touched in bounds. You got Smith as well. They got a few options.
Yeah, they got a few options, no question. But I think you want to release people to the glass like Smith and Jones, who are good offensive rebounders, and you want to get the ball in the hands of one of your shooters. And Dunham's a guy I'd like. But on the other side, they're going to counteract that. They know about Dunham. So you got to really try to get him free with a good screen. Let's see what they do. They're not going to bother the guy on the baseline. They'll let him throw it in.
Campen again. He's a guy who hardly ever plays, but obviously a guy they like to throw the long touchdown pass or football-type pass. He's going to be in there to inbound the ball again for Butler.
Don't remember this. With Hill and Leitner, they allowed him to throw it in. Uh-oh.
A travel is called on Barlow.
He lifted his pivot foot. He lifted his pivot foot. There's the pass, but watch this. He dragged his pivot foot, no doubt about it. No doubt about it. Before he put the ball on the floor, the foot came up.
And now if they don't get an immediate steal, they'll have to foul.
Foul right away. And then you got to hope for a dramatic three.
Oh, boy!
Oh,
they got it!
Jones!
Yes!
I can't believe it. Are you serious? Are you serious, America?
miscommunication between him and Olynyk, and Roosevelt Jones, who you described so accurately earlier as a winner with the winning shot. The officials are reviewing it to make sure it left his hand before the expiration of time. With the naked eye, it looked like it was good.
I thought it was good. Now they have to make a call, make a definite call, and then go. Yeah. And then they have to go and check the monitor.
Look at the far end. 0.1 on the clock. The ball's out of his hands. That looks like a good shot.
Good shot. But number one, they have to make a call. They have to make a call. They just say no with Butler.
Butler wins.
Undefeated at home. Yeah, 9-0. Beat a top-notch Rolls Royce team. And those kids go to the locker room to play their hearts out. Gonzaga. What a terrific night, Dan. It's been fun being here with you.
Just walking over near us. I think Shannon's going to get him for an interview. And all Brad said to us was, Hinkle magic. And there was some magic in the air here tonight as Roosevelt Jones saw the ball floating in the sky up above him, corralled it, and made that running one-hander with a tenth of a second left on the clock. And the Butler Bulldogs pull out an incredible win, 64-63.
Hey, Dan, think about emotions. You got Mark Few. He's on cloud nine with the turnover by Barlow. And then here it is a moment later. Roosevelt Jones with a dramatic shot. Gutty, tenacious.
More when we come back on SportsCenter. Brad Stevens and more reaction to the Butler win. Robert Flores and Jay Harris are standing by. 64-63. Butler beats Gonzaga here at Hinkle.
My goodness, what a basketball game.
That's why sports is awesome right there.
Yeah, hey there. Welcome to the latest live edition of SportsCenter. Alongside Robert Flores, I'm Jay Harris.
Sad day in baseball with the passing of two Hall of Famers. We have much more on their legendary career shortly. But first, what a night in college basketball.
Back out to Hinkle Fieldhouse, Shannon Spake and the winning head coach, Brad Stevens.
That is right. Talk about some energy. The game has been over for a couple minutes, and these fans are still going crazy.
Shannon, Reese Davis, Jalen Rose, Jay Billis here. They've stormed the floor at Hinkle. We had five games matching ranked opponents today. Three of them came down to the final possession, and none of them better than the nightcap that we just saw here with Roosevelt Jones going all Bobby Plump on the people and hitting the buzzer beater to win the game for Butler against. defense of Gonzaga, 64-63. Not a thing of beauty the last couple of possessions for each team, but Butler, as Brad Stevens just said, Jay, showed incredible toughness.
Both teams showed incredible toughness, but Roosevelt Jones was the toughest man on the, he was a man of the match all game long. And in the second half, when he would catch the ball at the elbow, up top, anytime he put the ball on the floor, he was seeking bodies and seeking contact and finishing plays through that contact. And what Brad was saying, I thought was really interesting. He may have the ugliest jump shot in college basketball, but he's got one of the five prettiest floaters. Yeah. And when he gets in the lane, puts that thing up, it's got incredible touch, and he puts it up with great flow. It's a terrific looking shot. But his jump shot, you got to close your eyes for it. It's amazing.
Here's a lesson. Stay in the moment. Things happen during the course of a game. You got to continue to play and keep your poise. Turnovers late by both basketball teams. Big Shot Barlow, as I'm calling him. He makes a turnover with 3.5 seconds. Then all of a sudden, Stockton, sideline out of bounds. He turns it over. Jones, the man of the moment, with a nice runner. As you mentioned, jumper isn't pretty, but man, I know that has to feel good.
And how about it coming down to the end of the game, how important passing and catching is. Mm-hmm. Inbounding the ball. You know, you mentioned Barlow's turnover on an inbounds play. Mm-hmm. And then Stockton's turnover on an inbounds play winds up leading to the game-winning basket for Butler. Passing and catching could have sealed it for Gonzaga.
Both of these teams have been off to